Okay, thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Jean Oy. I am the professor in political science and the director of the China program. Today we're here for the Oxenberg Lecture, which is held on, held annually to honor the legacy of Michael Oxenberg. Mike was one of the most influential scholars on China, and he's probably the teacher of the largest number of students who have gone on to be professors of Chinese politics themselves. He started his teaching career here at Stanford, and then went to Columbia University, and then eventually to the University of Michigan, where I think he had the largest number of students, and I'm very fortunate to count myself among those students. And the number of graduates in Chinese politics from Michigan is so large that there's now a nickname for us called the Michigan Mafia. And I'm actually really delighted that his son David is able to join us today. And even though this will date me, I still remember David's paintings decorating Mike's office. So when I went for office hours, I was always looking at his art. It was pretty good. And so it was a really unexpected honor and delight that Michael Oxenberg and I would become colleagues here at Stanford University in the late 90s, when Stanford made a big push to hire a number of China specialists at once. Mike was a senior fellow at the Shorenstein APARC and the Freeman Spogli Institute for International Studies. It is very sad that cancer took us from him, in 2001. Now, in addition to being a central figure in academics, Michael Oxenberg served as a key member of the National Security Council when the United States normalized relations with China. And he consistently urged that the United States engage with Asia in a more considered manner. And in tribute, the Oxenberg Lecture recognizes distinguished individuals who have helped to advance understanding between the United States and nations of the Asia Pacific. And following in that tradition, it is my honor to introduce the 2016 Oxenberg lecturer, James Steinberg. James Steinberg is the Dean of the Maxwell School of Citizenship and Public Affairs at Syracuse University, and he is concurrently the University Professor of Social Science, International Affairs, and Law. Now, prior to his becoming dean, he himself had a very number of distinguished positions, important positions in the government. He was one of the co-leaders of the President-elect Obama's transition team in 2008, working on national security issues. Later, he served as the Deputy Secretary of State in the Obama administration, and serving as the Principal Deputy to Secretary of State Hillary Clinton from 2009 to 2011. And then earlier, he also served in President Bill Clinton's administration. He held the position of the State Department's Chief of Staff and as Director of Department's Policy Planning Staff, as well as President Clinton's Deputy National Security Advisor. And in addition to that, he then went on, has served as the Dean of the Lyndon B. Johnson School of Public Affairs at the University of Texas at Austin, and as the Vice President and Director of Foreign Policy Studies at the Brookings Institution in Washington, He also is co-author of two important books, Strategic Reassurance and Resolve U.S.-China Relations in the 21st Century, and the earlier one called Difficult Transitions, Foreign Policy Troubles at the Outset of Presidential Power. Dean Steinberg earned his undergraduate degree from Harvard and his law degree from Yale. And so please help me welcome Dean Steinberg.
Thank you, Jean, and thanks to all of you for coming out on this beautiful day. I'm sure there are lovely opportunities to be outside, but I'm grateful to be able to spend a little time with you this afternoon. And it's a special pleasure for me and an honor to be here with you today to present the Oxenberg Lecture for 2016. There are many reasons why this is a great personal pleasure. First, the opportunity to be with so many friends and colleagues from in and out of government. First, to Mike Armacost, who brought me to Brookings when I was vice president for the foreign policy program. Mike was the leader of Brookings. And also to Tom Finger, who was a colleague of mine in my first stint at the State Department. I first served as a deputy assistant secretary in the Bureau of Intelligence and Research with Tom and learned a lot about that world from him. And also Kathy Stevens, who was also a colleague of mine from the State Department, who worked with me to help navigate one of the most successful peace processes of the modern era, that is the peace process in Northern Ireland. And then for her payback for her success, the opportunity to manage one of the least successful results in peace processes, which is the ongoing conflict on the Korean Peninsula, but where she served with enormous distinction and is a real tribute to the incredible talents of our career Foreign Service officers who can perform such heroic skills in so many different contexts. They've all three have made extraordinary contributions as public servants and continue to do so here at Stanford, where APARC continues to be one of the most important centers in the world in helping us understand the dynamic East Asia region. The second reason it's a great honor is to be the latest in a long line of very distinguished policymakers and thinkers who have had the opportunity to give the Oxenberg Lectures over the last 15 years and who have helped shape thinking both in practice and in words in our policy towards China and East Asia over the past five decades, beginning with the inaugural Oxenberg Lecture, President Carter. But most of all, the privilege comes from the opportunity to pay tribute to the legacy of Michael Oxenberg, who, as Jean said, was for generations a mentor and a model of engaged scholarship. Michael Oxenberg's career demonstrated the invaluable contribution that thoughtful and informed scholarship can make to enlightened policy, and conversely, how the experience of policymaking can help lead to better scholarship. At the time of the first Oxenberg Lecture, sociology professor Andrew Walder, who was the co-director of APARC and a former student of Mike Oxenberg's, recalled his mentor as an influential scholar on China. He said he was the country's most experienced senior advisor to U.S. governments on China and someone who, as Jane said, trained more students in contemporary Chinese studies during the last 25 years than anyone else. Michael Oxenberg was able to move effortlessly between academia and politics and connect with a variety of audiences in and out of government. Professor Walder also said at the time, as China scholarship has become bigger, it's become more fragmented, but Michael Oxenberg could pull it all together. This important insight is at the heart of what has made APARC such an important center over the years, and this theme about the relationship between the academy and policymaking will be a topic that I want to address at the end of my remarks today. But I want to begin with the overriding question that framed Michael Oxenberg's career, the management of U.S.-China relations. His career not only spanned a remarkable period in the evolution of China as an increasingly powerful and influential political actor, but he himself played a critical role in helping to devise a successful strategy to cope with the emergence of China and establish a framework for the constructive management of U.S.-China relations. Of course, he was not alone in this effort. Successive practitioners and thinkers from the Nixon, Carter, Reagan, Bush, and Clinton administrations built a sturdy bipartisan framework that survived the vicissitudes of political campaigns and changes of party holding the presidency. But the work of those who were present at the creation of this relationship in the 1970s deserves special acknowledgement for their wisdom, their foresight, and their courage in the face of serious obstacles at home and abroad. On the way down here to Stanford today, I had a chance to listen to a recording of an old Charlie Rose program in which both Michael Oxenberg and Richard Holbrooke were talking about the passing of Deng Xiaoping. And it reminded me of how fortunate we have been to have such great public servants to help shape the policy of our time. And I commend this to you. You can find it on the Charlie Rose website. The basic premise of the consensus that people like Michael Oxenberg helped build is well known to all of you. And it was summed up in a short piece that he wrote with Elizabeth Economy for the Council on Foreign Relations in 1997, reflected in the canonical phrase that the United States seeks a strong and prosperous China. Another way he put it was also in this an interview with Charlie Rose, in which Michael Oxenberg said, "We have an interest in a stable, secure, effectively governed China that contributes to the peace and stability of the region." This set of ideas, this principle, was based on three deep convictions. First, that the United States and China had a shared stake in the stability and prosperity of East Asia. Second, that both stood to lose from unbridled rivalry. And third, that the differences that did exist, especially with respect to our political and economic systems, while serious, could be managed constructively. This consensus, built first in the 1970s and continued over several decades, not only benefited the people of the United States and China, but the rest of the region as well, including U.S. allies, as both Mike Armacost and Kathy Stevens can attest. Now, of course, this consensus was not without its critics. From Nixon's first trip to the decision under President Carter to normalize relations with the People's Republic and end our formal recognition and security ties to Taiwan, to the Tiananmen events, to the Taiwan Straits missile crisis of 1996, and beyond. And throughout this period, successive American political campaigns featured candidates who accused the incumbent party of cozying up to communist dictators at the expense of American values and interests. And I should know, I worked for President Clinton when he ran for office in 1992. But after each election, the consensus policy reasserted itself. And again, I was part of that story, having worked to help restabilize U.S.-China relations in the wake of President Clinton's initial effort to try to leverage trade policy in support of human rights in China. Now, this approach that was built by the United States was matched by China's apparent acceptance of the basic principles that allowed for the consensus to be maintained in both countries, a willingness by China not to challenge the U.S.-led international order in East Asia and beyond. From Deng Xiaoping's admonition, and Tom, you'll forgive me the pronunciation, to Tao Guang Yang Wei, that is to bide our time, to hide our light, to the decision to join international regimes, from the NPT to the WTO, China, for the most part, pursued its path of growth without directly challenging the United States, our allies, or the post-World War II international order. As the millennium turned and China continued to rack up extraordinary economic growth, and with its enhanced political and military power, the voices challenging this consensus continued to grow louder, especially in China among former members of the PLA. And this was matched in turn by voices in the United States who began to insist that there was an inevitability to U.S.-China confrontations. This growing sense of pessimism was captured by Michael Oxenberg in a chapter he wrote in 1997, a chapter entitled China, a Torturous Path Onto the World Stage. He wrote, "In the mid-1990s, some Americans, including some members of Congress, began to speak of China as the next U.S. enemy, and China's leaders began to believe that the United States was seeking to return to its 1950s policy of seeking to encircle and isolate China." Although these fears began to grow in the late 1990s, and despite early tensions during the beginning of the Bush 43 administration, stemming from President Bush's early comments on Taiwan and the EP3 incident, the first decade of the 21st century proceeded relatively smoothly in U.S.-China relations, aided by a post-9/11 focus on terrorism. But as the decade drew to a close, the alarm bells sounded again, fueled by an apparently expansive Chinese maritime claims in the East and South China Sea, and by a growing sense by some in China that the financial crisis of 2008-2009 presaged an era of rapidly declining U.S. power and influence, creating an opening for greater Chinese assertiveness. Indeed, some in China began to argue that the time had come for China to abandon the self-effacing model of international behavior advocated by Deng Xiaoping in favor of Mao's more assertive China has stood up. These tensions surfaced early in the Obama administration and have only deepened since, matched by growing Chinese alarm at what many saw as the underlying premise of the Obama rebalance, a premise which many Chinese saw as simply an ill-disguised effort to contain China. So to give you a sense of where we had come by 2010, I was rummaging through my files and found this cover of The Economist, now 6 years old, The Dangers of a Rising China, something which we can see every day in the news as we read it. So this brings us to the core question. Have we reached the end of the consensus policy that was launched in the 1970s and carried us until the early 2010s, in which the United States seeks constructive relations with China based on China's willingness not to directly challenge the U.S. role in the region and beyond? Should we now prepare for a coming and inevitable contest of wills? And importantly for this audience, how can scholars help practitioners to understand the developments that we see taking place in China and throughout the region, and how to shape U.S. policy accordingly? As I've argued elsewhere, including in the book I wrote with Mike O'Hanlon that Gene mentioned, much of the debate over the future of U.S. policy is a debate about how to assess China's intentions. Are China's goals maximalist, as some, such as Michael Pillsbury, have argued, a 100-year plan to dominate the world? Was China's early restraint simply a matter of biding time until China became strong enough to assert its will and seek to dominate? Or are China's aims more limited, although still deeply problematic, such as seeking a Chinese Monroe Doctrine for East Asia, as perhaps foreshadowed in Xi Jinping's comments at the Conference on Interaction and Confidence Building, CICA, in which he argued for an Asian-only solution to Asia problems? Are Chinese territorial claims self-limiting to the recovery of territory lost in the 19th and early 20th century and promised back at Tehran and Potsdam? Or are Chinese moves simply defensive, simply to prevent a recurrence of the century of humiliation? Now, scholars of varying stripes have offered their own answers to these questions based on their own academic bent. Some neorealists have argued that a future of conflict is foreordained by the inevitable tensions between a rising and established power, the so-called Thucydides trap, although my good friend Joe Nye has argued that Thucydides may well have gotten it wrong in pointing to the conflict between Sparta and Athens as the source of the war. Others, from academics like John Eikenberry to practitioners like Don Gross, have argued that economic interdependence will inevitably temper conflict and lead to crisis management rather than confrontation. Still others, and I include myself in this group, fret about an emerging security dilemma that, despite the intentions of each side, could lead to a lose-lose, maybe even a catastrophic lose-lose outcome, an outcome all too vivid as we mark and reflect on the centennial of the slaughter that was World War I. To put the question another way, how should we understand Chinese foreign policy? As a long-term strategic plan to restore the glory of the Qinlong Emperor? As the most recent manifestation of a long-term strategic Chinese culture, the culture of the assassin's mace, as an adaptation to the shifting balance of regional and economic military power in favor of China, as the Communist Party's strategy for diverting domestic discontent by mobilizing nationalist pride, as the weakness of civilians in the face of an increasingly powerful military, as the outgrowth of an increasing cult of personality around Xi Jinping. Michael Oxenberg's own life and work cautioned against adopting any one simple explanation to explain China's foreign policy. In another appearance on the Charlie Rose Show, he said, "There is no single truth about a country as complex and diverse as China." In the chapter I mentioned earlier, he drew on his multiple academic strengths, from history to studies of strategic culture, shifting power balances, and the role of personality in bureaucracy, to help explain China's policy at the turn of the millennium. He placed particular emphasis on the capacity of China's leaders to manage, in his words, China's daunting domestic challenges. And he cautioned, and again I'm quoting, that neither China's historical legacy, nor the geostrategic context, nor the intellectual milieu have predetermined China's history. But more than anything else in his work, he focused on the deep uncertainty surrounding China's long-term direction. It's that uncertainty which lies at the heart of the challenge of developing sound policy for the United States. That uncertainty takes many forms. Part of the uncertainty about understanding China's intentions lies in the nature of the political process in China itself, opaque and secretive behind the walls of Zhongnanhai. But even if, by whatever means Tom Finger and his former colleagues might care to share with us, we could determine with some confidence those innermost secrets of the current leadership, that wouldn't necessarily tell us much about the intentions of future Chinese leaders. And for long-range policy purposes, that's at least as consequential as the current leader's intentions. And even if we could surmount that challenge and had some insight into future leaders' intentions, and even if we knew who they would be, exogenous events, as our political scientist friends call them, could throw all that prognostication into a cocked hat. In the end, a policy based on future intentions or confidence about future intentions is subject to what I call radical uncertainty. And that humble acknowledgement of radical uncertainty, rather than the confident predictions of both pundits and scholars, must lie at the heart of developing a sound approach to managing U.S.-China relations. Now, uncertainty can have a pernicious effect on policy. In the face of uncertainty, it seems tempting, indeed sublimely rational, to adopt a hedging strategy. Hope for the best, but prepare for the worst. The problem with hedging strategies is that they can be self-fulfilling. What looks like a hedge to one actor could look quite threatening to the other, and it can induce reciprocal hedging that indeed induces a downward spiral of the security dilemma, something Michael Oxenberg and Elizabeth Economy warned about in their CFR report when they observed, in thinking about the dangers that many had raised about the future of China, all these cautionary notes have validity. But what is the appropriate response to these concerns? To look on China as a potential enemy and work to isolate, weaken, or divide it, thus helping to create what the United States should seek to avoid? Surely not, they concluded. Now, to break this spiral, many have advocated a strategy of building trust. But trust building is also subject to many of the difficulties that give rise to uncertainty in the first place. What is the nature of that trust? What should we take in terms of the commitments on each side? And even if we have commitments from the current leaders, how will that help us for the future? It's no accident, for that reason, that President Reagan so famously observed with respect to arms control agreements, yes, we should trust, but also verify. This idea of verification, this idea of building trust not through words but through deeds, is the idea behind the concept of strategic and reassurance and resolve that's the subject of Michael Hanlon and my book. The goal here is to do what we can to clarify the uncertainties about each side's intentions by offering each side the opportunity to challenge each other to make clear and try to remove the inherent ambiguities by addressing directly the underlying concerns that each feels about each other's behavior. We can see the need for trying to deal with this problem of ambiguity and uncertainty in some of the most pressing issues that we face today in U.S.-China relations. For example, as the United States and our allies continue to be concerned about the long-term goals and intentions behind China's building spree in the South China Sea, there's a responsibility on China to make clear that its words of reassurance, that it does not intend to militarize the region, is backed up by its actions, and that it takes steps to show that what it purports to be doing is consonant with the actions which it is actually pursuing. But of course, this responsibility to try to address sources of anxiety and to resolve ambiguities needs to lie on both sides. And so as the United States and our ally South Korea begin to contemplate the deployment of the THAAD missile interceptors to deal with the North Korean nuclear program, it is our responsibility to demonstrate in concrete ways to China, as we say in our words, that the nature of this deployment poses no threat to the fundamental security of China itself. Now, this process of strategic reassurance, of trying to address ambiguities and try to resolve uncertainties, is not a foolproof answer to managing U.S.-China relations, in part because of the inherent ambiguity in any action and the difficulty of getting that kind of clarity through action. But it's also the case that it's not a perfect answer because, in some respects, our problems come from misperception. But in some respects, our problems come from deep differences in interest. And no amount of reassurance and resolve will help resolve a question when both sides fundamentally disagree about clear goals and long-term intentions. But the advantage of such an approach is that at least it clarifies it. And if we are destined to have conflict and rivalry, at least it should be based on real differences and not on misperception and apprehension not based in fact. This is a long-term process. It doesn't take place in one day or one week or one month or one year, because it is a dynamic relationship in which each side begins to try to understand and explore the actions and the intentions of others. It requires a sustained engagement, but it also requires an effort to take concrete actions to address each other's concerns. Now, Michael Oxenberg was an optimist about the direction in which U.S.-China relations would go. He said, "The record suggests that enlightened self-interest on both sides will prevail." But the question is, does the current record, as we watch the actions coming from China today, support the optimism that he espoused? I confess my own optimism is waning, in part because I am concerned that the leaders today in China are not meeting Michael Oxenberg's call for enlightened leadership. There's been a lot of dialogue and some progress in our relationship, as we've seen in the recent agreements on climate change that paved the way for the Paris Climate Summit. But the broad deterioration in public attitudes in both countries towards each other is a further cause for concern. There's an urgent need for both sides to step back beyond the day-to-day back and forth to try to steer a different course. We see some signs of hope, for example, in the recent efforts to try to address this very critical and nagging question about the potential for cyber espionage and cyber conflict. And the visit of the Chinese leader Meng Jianzhu to Washington before Xi Jinping's visit last September reflects to me an effort to engage in that very act of trying to deal with concrete problems, with concrete actions that potentially could change the rather unfortunate direction that is taking place in our relationship. And this process needs to take place with respect to the full range of issues that we have amongst us, whether it's the South China Sea, whether it's the North Korean nuclear program, whether it's the continued support in Pakistan for forces that are threatening the peace and stability of Afghanistan and the like, we need to deal concretely and in very pragmatic ways with taking steps that give each other confidence that our paths are not necessarily in conflict and that the nature of our shared interests are sufficient to continue to justify building that consensus that so long dominated U.S.-China relationships. Now, this process would be difficult if it only involved the United States and China. But critically, this is a relationship that affects not only our two countries, but the rest of the world as well, and especially the countries of the East Asia region. And just as we begin to try to deal with building a constructive relationship with China, we have to make sure that those efforts do not inadvertently undermine these critical relationships that we have, especially with U.S. allies in Northeast and Southeast Asia. The challenge to reassure China without undermining the confidence of our allies makes the challenge of diplomacy all the more difficult. And this is a topic I hope we can explore in the discussion, since we are fortunate to have Mike and Kathy on the panel in talking about these issues. And if that weren't complicated enough to manage the relationship going forward, we have to do this in the context of a presidential election year in the United States, which, as we all know, has not necessarily been felicitous to managing in a constructive way U.S.-China relations. Now, that's a big and tall order. But the question then becomes, what should we think about in terms of the contribution that we all can make to these challenges going forward? And in particular, if, as I've argued, that uncertainty is so fundamental to managing and developing a policy towards China, is there any role for scholarship to play in this? After all, if we can't know the answers to these questions, what can the work that we do in universities and think tanks contribute to helping policymakers manage the relationship? And I would think the answer here is not the simple answers that Michael Oxenberg cautioned us against, that there'd be a single point answer to trying to know what the direction will be or what the outcome will be, but rather the contribution that we all can make, and this is something that Tom Finger knows so well as his work at INR and in the intelligence community, is how scholarship can help us not get the answers, but at least get the questions right. What would we like to know more about? What are the critical factors? What issues should we be exploring? What trends, what long structural trends, what developments, social, political, cultural, economic, should we be following that influence the course and the choices that these countries are making, and particularly the choices that China is making? Scholarship here can make a great contribution in examining the way in which different factors contribute to the outcomes of policymaking, and therefore help policymakers think about how to clarify these uncertainties that necessarily drive our policy. But in order for that scholarship to be able to help make us understand the right questions, to think about what the right issues to research, what kinds of contribution research can make, it's important that our government officials have the ability to evaluate the scholarship that's coming out of the academy, and in turn, that the scholars who are doing the research and the writing understand what the issues are that officials are interested in and what kinds of analysis is most helpful and what they most need. This was Michael Oxenberg's great insight and what he brought to his work, having lived in both worlds. Indeed, as Dan Okamoto said, Mike had his feet in many different worlds. First and foremost, he was a scholar. He wrote a number of books on policy and politics. He was also a policymaker and maintained a commitment to making scholarship relevant to the real world. Our challenge, for those of us now in universities, is to train a next generation of scholars, just as Michael Oxenberg trained his, to be able to talk and operate in both worlds. This is a particularly critical challenge when I regret to say that some trends in universities and the academy seem to be going in the wrong direction. At a time when we see area studies, for example, under challenge in many universities, multidisciplinarity disfavored in favor of strong discipline trends, And students in our graduate programs often forced to make choices early in their careers between an academic and a practitioner's career and penalized for trying to live in both worlds. Many of us have devoted our efforts to try to help bridge that gap, both in our own work as scholars, as practitioners, to try to maintain our ties and contacts with thinkers in the universities and think tanks, but importantly, as I said, to embark on this critical question of making sure that the next generation of both scholars and practitioners can be as effective as Michael Oxenberg was in both worlds. This is why I think it's so important and that we continue to think about the legacy of his work and of his time both as a teacher and as a practitioner, as an inspiration both to those of us who continue to work in his shadow, but also to future generations to come. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. The format we're going to use today is that we're going to now have some commentary, and we're going to follow Dean Steinberg's recommendation, and we're going to call on people who have lived both in academia as well as having real-world policy experience. And so why don't I have our speakers come up, and I will introduce you as you're coming on stage. First, the three that I'm going to be introducing, Michael Armacos, Kathy Stevens, and Tom Finger, Dean Steinberg has already said quite a bit about each of them, but let me just highlight a few things. Michael Armacos, who I would like to ask to be our first speaker, is currently the Shorenstein A. Park Distinguished Fellow, and he's been at the Shorenstein A. Park since 2002. But prior to coming to Stanford, he had a 24-year distinguished career in government, a number of different positions, Under Secretary of State and Ambassador to Japan under President George H.W. Bush. And this was in 1989 when it was considered one of the most important and sensitive U.S. diplomatic posts abroad at the time. And then later, he was the ambassador to the Philippines. I'm sorry, earlier, he was ambassador to the Philippines in 82 to 84. He has also published, he actually started out in teaching as a political scientist and before going into government service. And I think he told me once that he thought it was going to be a very short stint that he was going to be spending in Washington. And so 24 years later, he comes back. And then he went on to become president of Brookings from 95 to 2002. And then our second speaker will be Kathleen Stevens, who is the William J. Perry Distinguished Fellow of the Freeman Spogli Institute of International Studies at Stanford. And she has a 35-year career in government. So she has also a number of very important positions in the Foreign Service. She was acting Under Secretary of State for Public Diplomacy and Public Affairs. She was the, as already alluded to, she was the ambassador to the Republic of Korea from 2008 to 2011. And then she was a number of other positions, including the Principal Deputy Assistant Secretary of State for the Bureau of East Asian and Pacific Affairs. And also she was the Deputy Assistant Secretary of State in the Bureau of European and Eurasian Affairs from 2003 to 2005, where she focused on post-conflict and stabilization issues in the Balkans. And I think this is what Dean Steinberg was referring to. And then finally, for our last speaker will be Tom Finger. And Tom is the Shorenstein Distinguished Fellow in the Freeman Spogli Institute for International Studies at Stanford. And prior to coming to Stanford, he got his degree at Stanford. And again, one of these people who thought perhaps he was only going off to Washington for a brief period of time. But as I'm correct, he spent about 30 years there. And then we were fortunate to have him come back. He was first deputy director of the National Intelligence for Analysis and concurrently the chairman of the National Intelligence Council. He also earlier had been the Assistant Secretary of the State Department's Bureau of Intelligence and Research, Principal Deputy Assistant Secretary, and he's also author of a number of important volumes. Most recently, Reducing Uncertainty, Intelligence Analysis and National Security, and a brand new volume that he just edited called The New Great Game, China and the South and Central Asia in the Era of Reform, both put out by Stanford University Press. And so what we're going to do is that I'm going to ask each of our speakers to make comments, and then after that we will have open it up for questions and answers. So I'd like to call Mike to come up first. Thank you.
Can I speak from here, or should I?
Sure. If you have the microphone, please do. And then we'll perhaps go to Kathy, and then we'll have Tom finish up.
Thank you. It's a great pleasure to be involved always in the Oxenberg Lecture. I worked closely with Mike Oxenberg on the National Security Council staff back in the 1970s. Mm-hmm. We had adjoining offices here in Hay Park in the mid-1990s. He's a great colleague, great friend. I think of him a lot, miss him a lot. And I think this is a proper and appropriate way to recall his contribution both to scholarship and to public policy. The second... I don't know quite how to fix this, but...
There you go.
Does that help? I've heard all the Oxenberg lectures save one. I wasn't back when Jimmy Carter spoke, but I've heard all the others. It's a very impressive array of people who brought both their public intellectual stature and the experience, stellar experience in making foreign policy, and Jim Steinberg, I think, is a perfect fit for that universe of people. I find myself in virtually total agreement with what he said, and instead of trying to align myself with what I agreed with, let me just make a few comments. It is true that in dealing with foreign policy issues of any consequence, there's an irreducible element of conjecture. One doesn't know the key features of intentions of other countries, particularly big, complex societies like China. I always remember when I was working for George Shultz, he inherited a year and a half in or so in the Reagan administration, among others, items on his portfolio in relation with China. And we were experiencing a lot of trouble with the Chinese, but George's approach was a very sensible one, in keeping with the spirit of Jim's remarks. He told his Chinese colleagues, look, let's sit down. We've got a lot of concerns about your policy. You no doubt have concerns about ours. Let us put them all on the table, make that our agenda, and commit to sitting down with one another at this level, periodically, and working our way systematically through that agenda. And he committed himself to listening to the Chinese. He committed himself to candidly expressing to the Chinese our view. And we did manage to stabilize the relationship, something that occurs, I think, almost every time there's a new administration. But it's an illustrative example of how you can not set the uncertainties aside, but reduce them to manageable portions by talking directly at a senior authoritative level in a regular way. Second, I remember working with Mike, our division of labor was he handled China, Indochina, Japan, Korea, and ASEAN countries, but there was a fair amount of overlap, so I learned a lot about China policy from Mike. And I remember that the focus in normalizing with China was on engaging them constructively, seeking to integrate them into a rules-based international system we'd largely constructed, assisting them in the important task of developing along market with Chinese characteristics line. And only later did we, as China's power grew, add hedging to this three-strand approach. And it seemed to me there is, as Jim said, an inherent tension between hedging on the one hand and constructively engaging on the other, but we're destined to do both and to do so in a thoughtful way. As Jim said, hedging can lead to conjuring up problems that you don't know would have occurred. But you can't afford not to hedge when you're dealing with a country that's as big and powerful as China, and which has interests which increasingly impinge upon our own. I'm struck especially by the fact that as China builds a naval, a blue water navy, it's intruding into maritime Asia, an area that we had largely to ourselves, as did the Japanese and other allies in Southeast Asia. So we're dealing with new dimensions of the China issue. I spent much of my career dealing with the Japanese, and it seemed to me Tokyo's point of view is relevant. And I think the Japanese understand the American approach of engaging China as we must. You know, $500 billion worth of trade, you can't make headway on big international issues without the collaboration, so we must engage them. At the same time, you must be cautious about the downside of a potential relationship which may turn into rivalry. And I think they find the current mix of hedging and engagement reasonably comfortable. The Japanese get uncomfortable if our relationship with China is too intimate or if it's confrontational. So they're comfortable with this mix of constructive elements along with the caution. And I think the current Abe administration has anchored its policy in the alliance with the U.S. because it's not only observed China's growth of power, but also its confrontation in a way over an island dispute in the East China Sea. So I think they have sought to deepen our alliance, making it more balanced, making it more global, making it more operational. And at the same time, they've sought to think about Alliance Plus. And increasingly, the Japanese want to multilateralize their security ties with us by engaging in trilateral security dialogues with the Aussies and the Indians and the Koreans. They want parallel tracks in helping the Filipinos or helping the Vietnamese increase their domain awareness, as the military says, about the South China Sea. So they're working in a direction which is compatible with balancing China. And at the same time, they got a huge trade, and they will continue to try and benefit from a huge relationship with China. So what I see from Jim's remark is a pattern of an approach which I think George Shultz pursued with great success, a set of policies that Mike authored, which have now been added to with the hedging element, and a view from Tokyo and perhaps other allies that finds pretty compatible this effort to maintain double track.
All right, well, thank you. I am really honored and delighted to be a part of this panel, and really pleased to see Jim Steinberg again. As he mentioned, I well recall meeting him about 20 years ago when he was at Policy Planning, and I know I speak for many, many Foreign Service officers when I say how much we benefited from his intellect, his wisdom, and also his skills as a practitioner. I recall Jim coming to Belfast, where I was the U.S. Consul General. He talked about the peace process there, which in retrospect is successful, but I remember a certain lunch I hosted for him that, where trust was so unbuilt that I had a lot of trouble getting people to sit down at the table, I think not because of Jim, because they didn't like each other. But more recently, as Deputy Secretary of State, I really wanted to say I appreciate so much the role that he played in shaping U.S.-China relations, U.S. or Trans-Pacific relations, and addressing some of the challenges that we faced during my tenure in Seoul, vis-a-vis, of course, North Korea, but also our work together with China. I came into the Foreign Service a long, long time ago, at the end of the 70s. In part because I was really looking forward to the normalization of relations with China. Since we've talked a little bit about students, I didn't have the pleasure of knowing or studying under Professor Oxenberg, but I feel like my career was also shaped by him. I, as a freshly minted foreign service officer with some college-level Chinese, probably not as good as many of those of you who studied Chinese here, but was sent to 4 months of kind of boot camp Cantonese and then sent to the Dongfang Hotel in Guangzhou to help to put on the ground through actions one of the fruits of normalization, and that is reopening our long frozen people-to-people ties. And with 4 months of Cantonese language, I turned down 90% of the student visa applicants who came my way over a converted bar counter. It was a lot different applying for a visa at that time, and with a PLA guard outside. I mention all that not to indulge merely in nostalgia, but to say, although I think there are reasons to temper some of our optimism about, and to certainly realize the challenges U.S.-China relations face today, it is also important to kind of recognize how far we've come. And I see it every day at Stanford. China sends more students to the United States every year, year in and year out, than any other country in the world. And I think that that will continue. The level of kind of obviously business, but also people-to-people rapprochement that we have enjoyed, I think gives an underpinning to the relationship, which is not sufficient, but I think it's very important and very helpful. Mike said a few things about the kind of perspective from Tokyo, and of course Secretary Steinberg in his lecture mentioned quite rightly that when it comes to U.S.-China relations, they matter not only to our two countries, but to the world and particularly to the region. And I have to say, although I confess to a certain South Korean or Korean bias, nowhere is that felt more strongly than in South Korea. You know, I mean, when you think about in Korea, that peninsula just off the Chinese mainland, I mean, here is a country with an extraordinary long and close historical and cultural association with China, and yet with one of the most difficult modern histories, including, of course, the fighting of a war on the peninsula and the division of the peninsula at mid-20th century. Normalization of relations between South Korea and China only came in 1992. So only last year did they celebrate, and it was kind of a tempered celebration, as it turned out, because things are there's good and bad in that relationship. The 25th anniversary last year, South Korea has a relationship with China, obviously economically so important, and yet increasing concern about the elements of competition in it, as South Korea works ever harder to try to stay ahead of the value chain and the curve. I think that South Korea's own relations with China has gone through some kind of, maybe as I said, some honeymoon periods, some positive periods, and some disappointments over time. Some of those, of course, have related to North Korea and the choices that China has made or sometimes not made vis-a-vis the challenges in North Korea. But overall, I think when you go to Seoul today, it's interesting. I mean, there are many attitudes you'll see that parallel, I mean, some of the concerns of our allies in Tokyo. But at the same time, I think that the South Koreans feel all that much more in the shadow of China and under some pressure, which they do not like, of having to somehow choose between China and the U.S. There are times when Chinese official spokesmen have made somewhat unhelpful comments like alliances or vestiges of the Cold War. And implied and sometimes more than implied, that on certain issues, Seoul should choose between the U.S. and China. To the extent that I think successive U.S. administrations, and I think particularly over the last, through the Obama administration, have made clear that this is not a zero-sum game, that a strong alliance, the strong U.S.-South Korea alliance, and indeed stronger cooperation with our allies in Tokyo as well, is not a zero-sum calculation when it comes to the understanding that, like us, South Korea must nurture on all fronts a strong and cooperative relationship with China. So I think their answer in Seoul to the question posed, Jim, in your lecture was be, it has to continue, not only U.S. and China, but more broadly in the region. I think you do see in South Korea, and this is a great deal of debate about, I mean, Mike used the term balancer as well. You hear that even more in Korea. Sometimes that is not well received in Washington, if there's a sense that somehow South Korea is going to see itself more as a free agent. I think this is actually an area where allies, including those in Tokyo, need to talk more frankly and more often with each other about how we see our own relationships as well as managing that with China. With respect to North Korea, and I just want to say, and Jim mentioned it in the context of the kind of menu of important issues on which I think there's at times some cooperation, not as much as we might like, and at times not, in the U.S.-China relationship and in dealing with the challenges of the North Korean, not only its nuclear weapons program, but the fact that it is such an anomaly now in the neighborhood. You know, the one place that has not joined, certainly not the 21st century, but is still caught in its own terrible time warp. I think there's room for some, if not optimism, some positive thoughts in terms of some elements that we haven't solved, as we were talking about earlier, the North Korean nuclear issue, nor the issue of as a North Korea more broadly, but the fact that China and the U.S. initially through the six-party talks have found a platform to work together on this is not insignificant and has also been important to our allies. The element of multilateralism in this effort is one that certainly Seoul is very interested in developing more broadly and may also help, I think, to address some of these challenges that come with to our allies and to others in the region as they look at the U.S.-China relationship.
You.
I also am delighted to be here, be a part of this panel, be a part of the Oxenberg lecture that I never studied with Mike, although he told me on a number of occasions that he was on the committee that admitted me to Stanford for graduate study many, many years ago, and then he left before I actually arrived. That among the things that have not been mentioned about Mike Oxenberg is that his role as the great puppet master or chess piece mover for the China studies field. It wasn't that he just trained a lot of people. Mike had very clear notions on what each of us in the field ought to be doing. And I discovered early on in the 1970s that I was beginning to get calls from inside government and other academic institutions. Would I be interested in serving on a staff or moving to the State Department or doing something at defense? And the "why are you asking me" question was usually met with a "Mike Oxenberg suggested that you would be good for this position." And Mike is the one who suggested me for the job that took me from Stanford to the State Department in 1986. I'm thankful for that. Jim Steinberg's talk, I think, was terrific. That means it's no fun to be on the panel commentating because it's much more fun to pick apart arguments. But I find myself in very, very substantial agreement. So what I'd like to do in the next few moments is to highlight a few of the points that he made that I thought were particularly worth noting, and to say a little bit about how the Chinese, or how I think the Chinese, view the situation that Jim described from the U.S. perspective. Mm. The first point has to do with the foundation under this relationship. A firm foundation was the words that Jim used, or sturdy framework. I agree with that as we encounter, deal with, or frustrated by problems in the relationship, it is important to remember that we have built a foundation from a single pillar of common, having a common enemy based in Moscow, to having an enormously diverse, complex, multifaceted relationship with a great many pillars. It is not a fragile relationship, despite the way it is described too often by commentators. Doesn't mean there are not problems. There certainly are. But the foundation is quite strong. One of the reasons for the strength of the relationship, beyond the multiplicity of strands in the relationship or pillars, is that it is built upon addressing, resolving, kicking down the road, or in other ways managing a multiplicity of problems, economic, political, social, geopolitical, military. We have gotten to know one another better because we have worked on concrete problems. This is not an abstract relationship that I think we've solved more than we've kicked down the road. This has given us understanding and experience. It's also given us expectations. And that gets to a second theme of Jim's talk, uncertainty. One of the observations that many of us who've worked on U.S.-China relations for a long time make is that we no longer have the confidence we once did that we understand what China is doing. That for basically three decades, we had a consensus that rested in part on an understanding of China's priorities, national security and economic development, modernization, at the top of that list, that requiring a peaceful, stable international environment in order to pursue its developmental goals, that it recognized the importance of the United States in achieving both of those goals. You had to make sure the United States did not threaten China's security too much directly for a long time, that it counterbalanced a threat from the Soviet Union, and that we could contribute and were willing to contribute to China's quest for sustained economic growth. The Chinese have been puzzled now for 25 years. Well, what the hell the United States is doing? That the assistance to development was predicated on, if we're going to have a partner in the never-ending struggle with the Soviet Union, we ought to have a strong partner. But this, that common enemy disappeared. And the Chinese, I think, are puzzled by why do the Americans continue to assist China's rise, China's development. I think they're mirror imaging to some extent. If the roles were reversed, there's very little in China's history that suggests that they would assist another country to become stronger and a possible peer competitor or rival. So we baffle them. We don't do what they would do if the roles were reversed. Some of the things, again, as Jim noted, that China has done, actions, in the last 5 or 6 years are puzzling because they no longer seem to conform to the model, the expectations, the trajectory that China seemed to be on as a very big but just another developing country, following the model that had enabled Japan, South Korea, Taiwan, and now an increasing number of countries to make a transition from an underdeveloped to a more developed, to a more diverse, more economically vibrant, more middle-class urban society. That sort of that path was well-worn. China seemed to be on it. Now it seems to be acting in ways that are hard to explain because it looks like they're moving away from the model and the reason isn't clear. I diverge into the China side a little more. I think most of the explanation for why China has departed from both the past trajectory and the projected continuation of that trajectory has to do with domestic concerns of the leadership. To take a very complicated argument and compress it down to a few words. the slowing of economic growth, which has been the principal source of regime legitimacy now for better than three decades, the success of the economic strategies that have created a much better educated, much larger middle class, urban, informed, connected population that is increasingly dissatisfied with the downsides of the developmental model that China has followed. The environmental degradation, the air pollution, the water pollution, the unsafe food, the expensive college educations that do not guarantee a job, and so forth. Leadership facing increasing internal challenges from a population that is very young. 70% of the Chinese population has no memory of China before reform and opening, of the China that was really backward and really screwed up. It's mostly single children. A whole country of spoiled brats with unfulfillable expectations who can't conceive why China should take a back seat to anybody. It's been so successful, why would you put up with crap from the Filipinos, the Vietnamese, the Japanese, or the Americans? And I think it pushes the leadership to do things that they'd rather not do. Among the things that they do that affect the United States has been making it harder for foreign businesses, including American businesses, to operate in China. The theft of intellectual property, the demands for transferring technologies, denial of national treatment, the failure to comply with WTO obligations. It's a significant list, even if it's not extraordinarily long. They've alienated the American business community. That's important because the American business community has been an important source of the stability in U.S.-China relations now for four decades. We've been through lots of presidential elections. China, either the real place or the mythical place, let's call it China, that features in presidential debates, is there. And after the election is over, it takes a relatively short, has taken a relatively short period of time for the business community to say to the politicians, that's enough. Let's get back on program here. This relationship is too important to us, and we are too important to you politicians to ignore this. This time around, the business community is sitting on the sidelines. Business community is not happy about China. It's not things that the U.S. government has done, it's things that the Chinese government has done in dealing with its internal problems, its conviction that the United States will not indefinitely assist China's modernization and development. So the final point has to do with the U.S. response. We shouldn't be, and I don't think Jim was implying at all, complacent about how firm the framework is, and that, as Mike said, the only possible outcome is the most logical one, that we have to continue to manage this relationship in a successful way. But to recognize that many of the sources of the most recent strains in the relationship are internal to China. And there's not much that Americans, American individuals or academics or government officials can do to address those root cause. What we can do and must do, and I take to heart Jim's challenge here, is for all of us to do a better job of analyzing, explaining, perhaps buttressing confidence that the engagement with hedging strategy that we have pursued is actually still working. And it's a better strategy than any alternatives. So we need patience, and we need the political environment here that will make it possible to continue to see China change in ways that are consistent with our interests and to remind China when it acts in ways inconsistent with our interests, that that's not in China's interest. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We should give the panelists and professor, particularly Jim, some time to perhaps respond before opening up to general discussion and questions.
Great, thanks, Jade. Just briefly, first of all, these are characteristically terrific responses and observations. I just want to reflect on one from each. I was particularly struck by Mike Armacost mentioning the issue of the Blue Water Navy, because it illustrates, as well as any issue can, the kind of deep dilemma that we face here. I think it was in 2006, then Secretary of Defense Rumsfeld went to this conference, the Shangri-La Conference, the IISS, which is the meeting of all the defense ministers from all the region. Mm-hmm. And he famously stood up in front of the whole group, including the Chinese, and said, "What do you need that military for? You don't have any enemies." You look back and you say, "Really?" you know, and if someone had said, you know, "Is that why people have the military?" And given the history and all of those things, is it imaginable that China would say, "Well, it's fine, we'll just let the United States take care of it, and we can count on them to protect our sea lines of communication, and they'll never do anything to threaten our access to oil, which our whole economy depends on, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera." So you step back and you say, well, of course, there's a perfectly legitimate reason why China would want to have a blue water navy. If you can, you would want to, right? On the other hand, there's a benign explanation for it, which is we just want to be confident that we won't be threatened and we can't be blackmailed. And there's a non-benign answer, which is we want to chase the United States out of the first island chain, the second island chain, the third island chain, take over Taiwan, intimidate. Both of those are consistent with China developing a blue water navy. So the question is, on the one hand, it's not enough to say, what do they need a navy for? On the other hand, it's not enough for China to say, oh, don't worry, we just want it for all these good reasons. And that is at the core of the challenge we have here, is to accept the fact that China is going to have a blue water navy, but to make clear to China that depending on how it does it, and how it interacts, and how it behaves, and what kind of operating rules it has, and how it can reassure us that its goals are consistent with the law of the sea, of international order. So it's a really beautiful illustration of the dilemma that we face here. On Kathy's points, which were really excellent, this issue about managing the region in ways that don't put, for either side to put pressure on our partners to see this as you're either with us or against us, I think is one of the really big challenges. We have to accept, the United States has to accept, that for the countries of the region, and South Korea is as good an example as any, of course they're going to have good relations with China. The economic ties, the people-to-people ties, oh, there are more Koreans studying in China than any other foreign nationality, right? The economic ties are incredibly, and we shouldn't want this to be something where we want Korea to have bad relations with China, or we want Japan to have bad relations with China. At the same time, we have to make clear that to China that they do not have the right to demand a kind of control over the region in ways that says you have to abrogate your alliance with the United States. This is our pond and you have to be on our team. It's understanding by both of us that the best of all worlds is for all the countries of the region to have good ties with both is the most stable outcome for all. And for a long time, as Mike said, the Chinese seem to accept that. I'm not so confident of that anymore. But given China's behavior, there's no danger that most of them are going to fall into China's orbit. The last thing, just on Tom's good points, I didn't say this in my remarks because I didn't want to be invidious. But we do have a sturdy framework, right? But if you look, I talked a lot about the report that Mike Oxenberg and Elizabeth Economy wrote in 1997 for the Council on Foreign Relations. There's a companion report that came out this year, I think this year, at least in the last 6 months, from the Council about U.S.-China relations, written by Ambassador Bob Blackwell and Ashley Tellis, which basically says it's over. We're going to have a contest, and the United States should seek primacy in East Asia because that's the only choice. Either one or the other of us is going to do it. And that's, pretty dramatic for the council. It's not a council document in that sense, but it is the same kind of publication that Mike and Elizabeth wrote 20 years earlier, which basically says, forget the old consensus and the old model. Now, I think there's been a lot of reaction against that and some questions about how it is that this got the implicit imprimatur of the council. But the fact that somebody like Bob Blackwell, who served with Henry Kissinger, with Mike and others, could you know, actually kind of say, no, it's time for a different approach, does tell me that the sturdiness of the framework is under challenge now, and there is a big responsibility on both sides, if we're going to sustain it, to deal with the skeptics, just as Mike sought to do in that report in 1997.
Discussion before opening?
It seems to me sensible that we didn't worry about the Chinese from a security standpoint so long as the Cold War was on because their troops were deployed on the northern border. And we didn't worry during Deng Xiaoping's preoccupation with domestic growth because they didn't have much of a foreign agenda. And both those things have changed. And so their power is greater, their interests have expanded. And we're dealing with one another as great powers historically have. There are elements of rivalry and there are elements of common interest, and we've just got to build on the latter and keep the former under control.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Those were very, very great comments. Let me now open it up to questions, and let me ask that people try to be very succinct so we can have as many people speak as possible. Yes, and please wait for the microphone. It's coming. And please identify yourself, if you would.
Well, there's one from Palo Alto. I have a question regarding North Korea. China has not been very helpful. You know, there is a lot of talk, but not many concrete action from their part, despite the fact they have a lot of leverage through trade with North Korea. So my question is, what could the U.S. do to get much more from China with respect to that problem? Could that be, for instance, offering some security guarantees in the peninsula, Korean peninsula, where, for instance, we would say the regime collapse, we would not move our forces up north? That would maybe reassure China a bit in that respect.
Go ahead.
We have a lot of expertise up here. You know, the Chinese response to North Korea is one of these classic glass half full, glass half empty challenges, which is, on the one hand, I think I'm persuaded personally that China understands the danger and the risk of the North Korean nuclear program and has a clear consensus and agreement with its partners in the region that denuclearization is a significant goal for all of us. On the other hand, for us, in particular the United States, but also for North Korea and South Korea and Japan, it's the most important goal, whereas for China, it's one of many goals. And some of these other goals lead it to temper its willingness to prioritize denuclearization and therefore pressure on the North. It doesn't want instability. It doesn't want migration flows of people across the border. It's got a lot of other things going on. It's got some economic interests. There are other historical ties. And so on the one hand, in relative terms, the fact that China has signed on to all these Security Council resolutions, that has imposed some sanctions, is really quite extraordinary given the historic relationship between China and North Korea. On the other hand, it isn't there. There's a clear limitation on what China is going to do. And frankly, I think we have to accept the proposition that there's a limit to how much we can directly do to get China to do more. However, I do think we can have more influence over China, because I think we have to make clear, and I think certainly when I was in government, we tried to make clear to China that there are consequences in the region for the failure to deal with the North Korean nuclear program, which are not necessarily things that China wants to see. Mm-hmm. I mentioned THAAD, the missile defense deployment. China really doesn't like that. But we have to make clear, and the South Koreans have to make clear, we're just going to do that. And that's just, if you don't like it, then do something about North Korea. But we're not going to accommodate you because you're not doing enough about North Korea. Similarly, more broadly, with U.S. presence in the region. The Chinese are uncomfortable with when we send the carrier into the East China Sea, right? I mean, to the Yellow Sea. And you know, we have to say, you know, well, if North Korea is going to do these things, we have to provide some reassurance to our allies. So I think that we need to be very clear to China that there are things that are going to happen in terms of our protecting our interests and our allies' interests if nothing more effective is done to slow down or stop the North Korean program and the China, and to make the choice more stark from China, to make it clear that there are costs for its not its unwillingness to go further in putting pressure on North Korea.
Well, would you say a word about secondary sanctions?
So I'm for secondary sanctions. I think that it's not a first favor thing, but as we saw basically in the case of Iran, that secondary sanctions can be very effective, and that China has to understand that that given the limitations of what we've achieved so far, that placing secondary sanctions on actors who do business with North Korea has to be on the table for the United States and our allies, even though that will be cause some tension in U.S.-China relations, that the stakes are simply too big here, and China needs to see this more as a choice between its sets of interests.
Kathy?
There was an announcement to that effect today, that some new financial sanctions have been introduced, and it'll be interesting to see how China responds. But yeah, I mean, I think, as you say, China has vast influence, if you like, over North Korea. What in its own view, I think, it feels it lacks is what it would consider to be usable leverage, that is, leverage enough to get the North Koreans to do what they'd like it to do, we agree, vis-a-vis its nuclear program, and actually in terms of economic reform, but short of creating conditions that would lead to instability and collapse, or a greater South Korean or U.S. influence on the peninsula.
Yes.
Is it working?
Yes.
Could I follow up on North Korea, even though this discussion is about China? There's a time limit. This idea of, you know, somewhere down the line, this may happen or not. The time limit is set by how long it's going to take the North Koreans to complete the development of an ICBM. And that time limit's probably between 3 and 5 years. They had another crash of a launch day before yesterday. But we had a lot of them, too, when we were developing them. So it's not just nuclear. The nuclear is the genie's out of the bottle, and I'm dubious that short of a regime change in Pyongyang, we'll ever get it back in. But what we will do, I think, is that we will find it unacceptable to have an ICBM-capable force in North Korea. And what we'll do is go for an Article 42 sanction, and then China will really be on the spot of what to do.
Well, the one thing I'm always cautious about is when we say things are unacceptable, words have meaning, and so we have to be prepared to understand that unacceptable can drive you to some policy decisions. So we really do need to decide whether that's really true, because we can follow a course of more pressure, but we can't be certain that that will work. And if it's unacceptable, does that mean we'd be prepared to use military options to deal with the program? I just raise that as a concern. How unacceptable will this be? And it's clearly undesirable at a very high level, but are we prepared to use all necessary means? I mean, not just 42 sanctions, but all necessary means, including force, to address it. But I agree with you that it's why we need to really take seriously the need that right now we are not exerting sufficient leverage to change the calculation of Kim Jong-un. It's clear, right? He thinks right now this is a pretty good deal, in which he gets to have his nukes, gets to develop his missiles, and pays only a modest price in terms of the other costs from sanctions and elsewhere. We have to test the proposition about whether there is a limit to how much he can tolerate in terms of additional pressure. I think that up till now, it's clearly been insufficient to change his calculus, and we need to explore all forms of pressure, at least short of force, and without necessarily taking force off the table, to test the proposition, as we did with the Iranians, about, you know, that there may be a point at which his calculus changes.
Here, let me just ask a sort of a follow-up question. Now, it's been asserted that China actually has a lot of influence on North Korea. But what are the signs that actually maybe their influence isn't as much as either we think or that they would like?
I think Tom, I think, can add a lot to this as well. But I think that the difference is that at one point we thought influence was you could send somebody from the PBSC and, you know, to Pyongyang and whisper something in their ears and they would do what they said. That doesn't happen anymore. That's clear. I mean, there's no question that, and I've heard this directly from some very senior Chinese officials who were sent on that mission, that they were treated very badly by the North Koreans, disrespectfully and all that, and they basically said, go take a hike. So in that sense, you know, big brother cannot tell little brother what to do. Mm-hmm. But do they have leverage? Sure they have leverage. I mean, they are still the economic lifeline for this regime. There's a certain degree of self-sufficiency in Juche, but it's not, it would be a very, very different and a very, very perilous situation for the regime if the Chinese decided that they were going to cut off that economic lifeline. Now, there are obviously, as we've heard, you know, reasons why China has been reluctant to do it. So, but do they have the ability to do things that would have an influence on the North Korean calculus? Sure.
There's no question that China has more leverage than anybody else, more influence than anybody else. That does not mean that they have a lot of useful leverage. From Beijing's perspective, yes, they could dramatically reduce North Korea's economic interaction with the outside world, since it's 85% with or through China, and that would inflict pain. The Chinese are extremely reluctant to use this, in my judgment, not because of lingering affinity for the North Korean regime, but because they worry about the response that North Korea might make. The North Korean capacity to make mischief, to destabilize the peninsula, to act in ways that perhaps could lead to war on the peninsula. And war on the peninsula for China is pretty much a home game. It destabilizes a region in ways that can affect China's own economic potential, trade. Are you going to, you know, insurance rates go up, shipping becomes more problematic. At some point, it will have to deal with its own credibility, since it does have a security alliance with North Korea. Which Chinese say does not apply if the North Koreans start it. But who starts it if it's a response to economic sanctions? I don't want to sound like a lawyer for the Chinese. I think they should be doing more. I think they can do more than they are. But the unwillingness to call the bluff of the North Koreans, who might do something that inflicts great pain on the South Koreans, that might involve us in ways that lead to a situation that the Chinese don't want to be in. And so far, their calculus seems to be, we can live with the unhappiness of the Americans and the South Koreans and the Japanese and others. We're not sure we want to live with the response that the North Koreans would make.
Well, I think for a long time their priorities were no conflict, no instability, no nukes. They allowed the inference here in the last year or two that no nukes had moved up.
Right.
I'm not clear that the evidence supports that. I think it would take, as you were saying earlier, some heavier pressure on the Chinese to test the proposition. Then you've also got 25,000-30,000 workers in Russia, I think, who are sending home remittances, which the government gathers that revenue and passes out a little bit of it to relatives. But that's a big source of regime income now. So
and Middle East workers.
And Middle East. So you'd have to go after those workers or the employment that gives them wages if you're making an all-out effort to really trap the North Korean.
I think we're right now still in the early stage of a period where there is a more concerted effort to bring some pressures on North Korea, including from China, than there have been in some years. I cannot be too optimistic about what results from that, but I think this is a period when those efforts are where we need to concentrate our attention, along with whatever quiet talks we can have with the Chinese as well as with our South Korean allies about what sort of diplomatic process, and we've been through a lot of them over the last 20 years, is available should the North Koreans, as one government official, come to their senses, if you like, or be ready to seek some relief. But there is a lot of long and hard experience in this, and I think we're going to have to try to use that experience along with this effort that it bears watching. As I said, I'm not going to predict success, but I think that the level of potential concerted pressure on North Korea now is greater than it has been in a very long time.
Yeah, I just add, just in response to the specific point, you know, there have been efforts to engage the Chinese with the kind of discussion about what would make you feel more comfortable about an aftermath, you know, in ways that the outcome would be one that's not threatening. Just as we saw in the case of German unification, when there was the discussion about not moving NATO forces into, the Chinese are very reluctant to have that conversation because they're afraid that the North Koreans will see this as a betrayal. And this will cause the very thing that they don't want to do. So the conversations take place at one remove, the so-called track 1.5 kind of thing. But there's a recognition that the issue that you've raised about, you know, there are things that might make it easier for China to see how this comes out in a way that's acceptable for China, and make that part of the way of trying to re-engage China on the question.
Yes, the gentleman over here, and then I think we had a question here as well, and then.
My name is Anupam Khanna. I'm a visiting scholar at the Precourt Institute from India. My question is occasioned by Mr. Stern's point about the new Blackwell Tellis book. As you know, those are the two point people on the relationship between US and India. And it's also been noticed their frequent trips. And this book has been noticed by the Chinese ambassador in India. We had a conversation just before I came. I haven't heard much about South Asia and even Central Asia, except the reference Mr. Finger made. Mm-hmm. But at least in Asia, the view is, forget the confrontation, but the competition that is going to occur between the US and China is actually likely to be played out in South Central Asia, Afghanistan being one, but the others, Pakistan being. So what do you think, how will this competition play out? Because let me just say, the Chinese are already reacting over the last year. Their overtures and engagement to go beyond the official talks, I mean, I can say that from personal experience, has really dramatically expanded. I personally think it's a good idea for the Chinese and Indians to engage in this. But so that was one question. If I could just make a small tribute to Mr. Oxenberg, which has not been said, I got my PhD here, and I was one of the people who opened the World Bank's office in the mid-80s in China. And I was in charge of industry and energy. And the Chinese, they were very amazed. And they always thought, how come you know so much about Chinese policy making? And they thought that the Indians knew it. I said, no. It was just that I'd read I think it was Oxenberg and Lieberthal's book on policy making in China, which was, I think, and I read it with Indian and Asian eyes. I think that might have been the only addition. And I think that shaped certainly a lot of our thinking on China, and the Chinese sort of appreciated it. So that was a tribute to Michael.
It's a very good book. You know, I think, I mean, you're right, this is a very important part of the dynamic. And just as I mentioned before, that, you know, with respect to our East Asian allies, that we shouldn't want to have an either or us and them proposition. It's not in our interest to get into a game with India that says, you know, you got to be an ally with us against China. But first of all, it's not going to happen, as you know. I mean, it's just not conceivable. But second, it's not desirable, right? I mean, we should want constructive relations in both countries' interest. You know, but like with our East Asian allies, I think our Indian partner wants us to be fairly clear that there are limits to what we will tolerate from China and that we expect China. And so certain, in my words, resolve is very important to India because it creates space for India to be able to have a constructive relationship with China. On the South Asia piece, I mean, you know, I read all this stuff about the string of pearls and, you know, and it's like the Blue Water Navy. I mean, there are parts of this which potentially are of concern and parts of this which are just natural. I mean, China's a big export trading country. It's going to need ports, Guadar, you know, Sri Lanka. And again, this is where one of the places where China needs to do a better job of being clear about what its expectations are, and the One Belt, One Road, and all of these things. There's a benign version of this, which is actually beneficial to everybody. Economic development in Central Asia and Afghanistan is good. The Chinese investment in mines in Afghanistan is good. We shouldn't see this as a necessarily bad thing. But there are aspects of it that are worrisome. I mentioned the thing about the Taliban. If China's going to be a strategic partner with Pakistan, it's incumbent on China to not turn its back on the irresponsible behavior of Pakistan with respect to terrorism, radical groups, and the like. And so, fine, you want to be engaged there. What are you doing to deal with these things that are of concern to India and the United States and others? And I think that's the real challenge for China now, is to step up to the plate and show that these things, its engagement in Central Asia and South Asia, are consistent with a more positive win-win strategy than one in which is designed to get back into a kind of competition.
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Why don't you?
We can.
I'm somewhat stunned that with this discussion. I'm certainly not the only one saying it. Ash Carter. Has launched what can only be described at best as a cold war against China. China's response to this has been very, very angry and very vocal. The U.S. administration, the tenor of the discussion is somehow China's got to demonstrate to the United States, who's carried out the worst foreign policy that I've seen in my lifetime, certainly in the past 8 years, and you must include the Bush administration. So China doesn't have to demonstrate anything. The U.S., especially this administration, has to stop pushing for war and conflict. I don't get this. This is just wrong. And I just wanted to say that. How can you justify teaching China a lesson? How can you justify China knowing what its limitations are? They've. I don't know the exact number. They brought 50 million people, you know, in a decade or more. 50 million people a year out of poverty. And in the United States, you could basically say we've had the exact different result over the past 16 years. So it troubles me that four members of the diplomatic community are tolerating some of the worst foreign policy of any presidency I've seen since George W. Bush.
Okay. Other comments? Yes.
Yeah, so if none of the speakers wish to respond to that speaker.
No, I'll be happy to respond. I mean, you know, we can have the debate, but because obviously I fundamentally disagree. But so let's talk about this. We have no reason to be concerned that China is building military airstrips on disputed territories, right? That this is not a unilateral action that should be concerned to others. That a country that claims to be committed to peaceful resolution and diplomacy unilaterally acts in ways to declare air defense identification zones. I mean, this is not consistent with international law. It's not consistent with diplomatic practice. You can argue whether the United States is being too aggressive in responding. There's some pluses, there's some minuses. But to simply turn your back and excuse the behavior of China in situations where it refuses to sign a code of conduct, It refuses to take a kind of a standstill approach to let the diplomatic process to work, to accept the arbitration of the Law of the Sea Tribunal. I mean, these you're not obviously addressing any of these actions which are cause of concern, not just to this horrible administration which has the worst foreign policy of all time, but every other one of its neighbors. And so this is not some kind of, you know, product of a warlike U.S. policy. It is a deliberate set of actions of China that have changed the status quo, which existed from the time when Deng Xiaoping said that we are not wise enough to solve these problems, we should put them aside, and we should peacefully work together, to a policy which is a change. And it is a change of unilateral action to assert Chinese claims that don't resort to diplomacy or negotiation or dialogue, but simply depend on the fact that China has now the capacity to act unilaterally. That is something that not just the United States, but every other country in the region is alarmed by and ought to be alarmed by. Now, China's had many opportunities. Xi Jinping went to Washington and said, oh, we don't intend to militarize these things. And then they continue to send military aircraft and military vessels to the islands. That's not consistent with what he said, and it's not consistent with demonstrating to others that somehow we're pressing him inappropriately. I think the United States has been reasonably restrained about all of this. The freedom of navigation operations are freedom of navigation operations. They're consistent with international law and with the international community's support. And so, obviously, I don't agree with your perspective on this.
It's also consistent with Chinese practice. The Chinese send military vessels into U.S. territorial waters. Freedom of navigation exercises. To the extent the U.S. even comments on it, that China is exercising its rights under international law.
In short, China has ratified the U.N. Convention on the Law of the Sea. They just don't adhere to it in the South China Sea. We've not ratified it. We do adhere to it.
Yes.
You now get a chance to have your question.
Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Ned Nergy. I'm with the Schiller Institute. My question is simple. I'd like to state the question. I'd like Kathleen, please, to respond first. And then I'll give just a little bit of background to the question. The question is, would it not be beneficial for the United States to accept the personal, in-person delivered offer from Chinese President Xi Jinping to the United States President Barack Obama in 2014 when Barack Obama was in Beijing at an ASEAN meeting, where President Xi Jinping offered that the United States should join China with the BRICS nations for development purposes? Yes, the One Road, One Belt program, which has already been mentioned, sometimes referred to as the New Silk Road, and beginning to be named the World Land Bridge. This offer was given in person, publicly, and Barack Obama's response has been silence. Now, if we proposed and went ahead with Xi Jinping's proposal, it would serve currently as a Marshall Plan type policy to the crisis in East Asia, particularly in Syria, particularly in Turkey, particularly in giving those populations a whole lot of work, productive work to do, rather than our blowing up the production, that's the buildings, the infrastructure that's already been built. We could actually build new with China's offer. That's an option of taking the terrorists off the battlefield and into the production cycle. China's also proposed to, on the continent of Africa, as part of the same policy, to interconnect attacked every national capital on the continent of Africa with high-speed rail, breaking finally and hopefully once and for all the imperial design of a rail from the mine to the port, and leaving the continent devastated. So that's the background to Xi Jinping's offer. I see only benefit in the United States' participation with that offer if indeed our intent is peace and development.
Or perhaps we should let those panelists answer. Kathy?
Well, yeah, let me just make a kind of general response. And I'm not so aware of the details of 2014, but certainly over the last year or so, are we talking about the AIIB here? Or,
I think so.
Yeah. I mean, first of all, I think a very important part of the U.S. approach to China, which I think generally we've honored, but sometimes perhaps not as fully as we might have, is the commitment to China integrated into international institutions, including development institutions, financial institutions, and so on. At times, I think we've been a little slow in that, and the voice of the traditional developed world, the United States and Europe, has continued to be rather strong. And I think it's been important for us to find a way to seek China's constructive participation. There should be a term called responsible stakeholder by a previous administration in those institutions. And there should be some new institutions, too. I think we should be open to that. And I think we should be open to the AIIB. There were concerns expressed about it by the Obama administration in terms of did it meet the standards of transparency and adherence to hard-learned lessons in terms of the kinds of development projects that work best vis-a-vis the environment and local concerns. I think that's all legitimate, but I think that we should have been more open, in my own personal view, to the notion of China also taking a more leading role in some of these development efforts. So I think when it comes to the AIIB, if that's what we're talking about, I mean, the administration itself sort of says, well, that was kind of misunderstood. I mean, whether it was or it wasn't, I mean, I think that's an example of where we need to make sure that our actions also match our principles and our rhetoric.
I agree with Kathy. I mean, I think we should have said yes, but to Xi Jinping's offer. Yes, but we need to be sure this is going to meet high standards and deal with corruption and things like that. But we should have been open to it. And I think in some ways, this is an example of cases where there was uncertainty about what the intention behind it. And rather than exploring it and trying to steer it in a positive direction along the lines that you said, people just assumed the worst and said, well, we can't do this because they're trying to undermine the ADB. And I think it was unfortunate because it was precisely playing this game of, you know, playing fearing the worst rather than seeking to bring out the best. So I hope that there's now an opportunity to step back from this. We've seen some positive signs from the at least the technical leadership of the AIIB that they do intend to maintain high standards. I'm a little skeptical about the viability of the rail project, but we shouldn't simply say no. We should explore it. We should see, you know, can this be made to work? Can this be done in a way that doesn't lead to corruption or double dealing and that sort of thing? But I think your basic point, I think, is the right one, which is that we should seek to turn these into a positive direction along the lines you said.
I think we have time for one last question, short one. Yes.
Okay, I'm Bill Fisher from Palo Alto, and this is about the businessman's hand in this. I'm under the impression that during the Irish famine, that the British businessmen were the ones who did the most to suppress Ireland. And ever since then, whenever there's a war, that the businessmen have an interest in exploiting the people of other countries. Now, maybe this is too simplistic, but that's how it seems to me, because our businessmen have been taking advantage of cheaper labor in China. The Soviet Union apparently is taking advantage of cheaper labor from North Korea. And if these guys could just not try to exploit others, that they would not put the pressure on the political politicians to get into a war. Is that too simplistic?
I'm the business lobby. Yes, I think it is too simple a description of a
multifaceted situation, that businesses pursuing commercial interest and seeking comparative advantage where there is low-cost labor, that will go on so long as there is capitalism on there. And the question for me is one of, what are the conditions or the rules that shape this? The labor provisions, for example, of trade agreements, or the ethical requirements not to blackmail and bribe in order to secure contracts. But the business community actions in another country are governed fundamentally by the rules, the laws, the legal structure of the country in which they operate. And U.S. engagement to enhance governance, rule of law, independent judiciary, all of those things to protect worker rights from all businessmen, from inside the company, country and outside, I think is an appropriate one. That expecting American businesses to apply rules in other countries that are U.S. rules strikes me as a stretch. But the point I was trying to make with reference to the alienation of the business community, the international community, but particularly the U.S. one, is China in recent years has imposed conditions that appear not at all aimed at protecting workers, Chinese workers from exploitation by foreign firms, but at extracting concessions from foreign businesses that they were not prepared to make, and that may cost the jobs of the people who now are employed in these foreign invested industries, that dealing with all of the manifestations of globalization, its impact on the countries that the receive investment, those that lose jobs, the impact that it has on availability of water and power, are really critical issues, but they have to be dealt with in the totality. I don't know how to get at one at a time dimensions of these problems. And it goes to the AIIB and in foreign investment. Foreign investment can be a very good thing. Infrastructure construction, it makes a lot of things possible. What are the conditions under which it gets made? Under the workers that are doing the work of constructing it is as important as who pays for it.
Our time is almost out, but let me just ask one question. But first I want to just say that in response that, you know, a lot of these discussion that we have here at Stanford and in some of the criticism and such, I don't think that anyone is belittling the great achievements that the Chinese reforms have made. But, you know, one of the things I'd like to underscore sort of in closing, but then also as a question to the panelists, and that is a remark that that Tom made. And on the one hand, I think that one of the key themes that came out is that basically you all are agreed that this is the foundation of this relationship is pretty strong, and that we have to keep keep working at this. But one of the comments that Tom made that is very worrying, particularly given this current presidential campaign, and then that is that the business community has been alienated, and they're not going to be necessarily, it's unlikely they're going to quickly come to the next president-elect and say, okay, enough, let's move back. So, what do you think it's the best thing that we can do as people in the academy, researchers, but as also others, like, how are we going to get this back on track if you don't have the business people pushing to get it back on track, and then you've got politicians on other both extremes, and you know, research has come out showing that globalization has actually very much hurt a lot of American workers' incomes and such. So this is a pretty trying time, and it's really going to test this foundation.
My comment would be that the businesses vary, of course. Apple is hugely dependent upon China, so they're going to work on these problems because they got a huge stake in a growing market. So I think businesses will take position based on where they see their own business going. But I think it's well to remember that during an election year, the critics of China tend to be on the wings of our spectrum. So you got the labor people, they don't like labor-intensive exports from China coming in the market. The human rights people don't like the treatment of dissidents. The evangelicals don't like the widespread use of abortion or religious persecution. So you got, during election years, the right and the left critics of China coming forth, and new administrations find they have to try and figure out a way to get a big relationship of importance to the U.S. back on track. I think the troubling thing about this election to me is that every candidate is an opponent of free trade. So something more fundamental is at work in the U.S. on this issue that is a big strand of the U.S.-China relationship. When you've got $500 billion worth of trade, somehow it's got to be managed. You want the public to understand the virtues of trade. You want your government to ensure that the rules are reasonably fair and fairly enforced. But I think the sea change that we're seeing now is a little different than previous election, so how we get back to something after the election is, I think, a more worrisome possibility than normal.
And I'd also say, you know, having written about the way elections affect the early years of the early months of administration, is that you know, you can recover, you can kind of reestablish balance, but how it's carried out and the kind of commitments that are made during campaigns do make it either easier or harder. And so it's important that as we go into it, one of the things that we can say is look back at, you know, prior examples. I mean, I mentioned my own experience in 92 and then 93, 94, you know, with Clinton and his campaign statements about linking MFN and human rights, and then getting in and finding that it didn't provide, rather than leveraging the Chinese, it was leveraging against us. And so we had to find a way to extricate ourselves and trying to get our political leaders to kind of anticipate the consequences of what they say. But I would say, you know, I mean, I don't want to be the pessimist of the group, but I, you know, I look at the opinion polling in both countries, and there is a significant secular deterioration in attitudes or mutual attitudes towards each other. The American attitudes, public attitudes towards China are becoming much more negative, much more skeptical, and much more concerned about China. And the same is true in China. I mean, obviously, we don't, quality of the polling is not quite the same, but I'm pretty confident that it is true that the underpinnings, the foundations, not just the business constituencies, but more broadly, the public constituencies that basically believe that we have a big stake in each other's future are not eroded completely, but they are less firm than they were before. And so it's not just a matter of what, you know, presidents and leaders and secretaries of state and foreign ministers do, but it's really addressing these public anxieties in both countries. I mean, there's increasing feeling in China that the U.S. goal is to weaken and contain China. There's an increasing sentiment in the United States that China is a threat both economically and politically, and we need to find a way to address those things, because leaders can't do this if there's no public support for this foundational relationship.
The only thing I would add is I think coming out of the election that the United States, as China is already, is going to be very much focused on internal considerations, problems, challenges, that probably the best that one can hope for is maintenance of the U.S.-China relationship and solving problems as they
demand attention or dealing with them as they demand attention. I don't see in the near term a very large possibility of qualitative changes in the relationship for the better. That the domestic support isn't going to be there, and the receptivity on the Chinese end isn't going to be there. They're going to be dealing with other problems, and certainly the Chinese perception of a U.S. effort to improve the relations is going to be another trick to erode support for the government.
Kathy, do you
want to add? I don't want to have the last word, no, but one word I take away from this that I think both Jim and Tom have used is uncertainty. I mean, uncertainty as we look at China. You know, what does China want in a broad strategic sense? What is its place in the region and the world? Uncertainty about its economic future, and uncertainty related to its domestic situation. And one thing the Academy can do, I think, is try to understand that better. Try to really delve into that, because I think policymakers and transitions are going to need that as we go forward. And I think we also have to keep in mind that the Chinese, as they look at us, probably feel a little uncertain about the United States. Maybe to try to understand and address some of that insecurity, to try to avoid falling into that kind of self-fulfilling prophecy that Jim was talking about.
Well, thank you very much. Let me just end by, again, quoting Mike Oxenberg, who always used to like to talk about contradictions. And this is a term that I find myself using in my lecture classes about talking about China, but I think also about the United States. And just to say there is, as you were saying, there's no simple, as you stressed, there's no simple understanding about China or about this very important relationship, but I think that we have no choice but to keep working at it. So thank you very much for all of your insights, and thank the audience.